gonna take me a while. I just hate making mistakes in front of people. Usually, like you, I try to hide my mistakes. So, restore, repay. If you had a choice, which would you rather have? Would you rather be repaid, or would you rather have the years restored? In the Lord's Prayer, the Greek text says, forgive us our debts. Then the Baptist changed that to forgive us our sins. And then the Methodist changed that to forgive us our trespasses, because we figure we don't ever do that anyway. So, would you rather have your debts forgiven or your sins? I want you to think about that, because how about, you know, having all your debts paid off? It'd be like winning the lottery, right? So, restore or repay, they both sound pretty good to me. So here's a prophet, and he says God's going to restore the years. It sounds like Joel's in competition with the cosmetic business. Don't you think that'd make a great cosmetic ad? Revlon will restore the lost years. Every year we spend $55 billion on cosmetics. I'm not opposed to it. I like the results. But this sounds like Joel's in competition with Mary Kay and Clinique and Revlon and Estee Lauder and Lancôme. Now, Revlon has a product called Regenerous. Actually, they have lots of products called Regenerous. In preparation for this sermon, I went to a local Walgreens and walked up and down the aisle and tried to write down all the products. I got tired and gave up. And this is not just about the ladies, because there's a whole line of products for the men. They have a product out there for men with gray hair. It makes the gray hair shine like silver. I got it. I use it every Sunday morning before I come, because I want my gray hair to be silver. Somebody told me that we guys actually look better as we get older. I don't know if that's just some lies you guys are making up, but we like it. Anytime you pay someone a compliment, remember there's only one appropriate response. Thank you. Do not make silly excuses and try to make me think that you are being humble. That makes you like the Pharisee in the Gospel of Luke today. If someone says you look great today, just say thank you. Because with the passing of the years, the number of times that someone stops and says that to you is going to decrease dramatically. I have a friend in Dayton who revels in being the corniest joke teller in the world. And when he says, when you say to him on Sunday morning, Bill, it's good to see you, he said, that's wonderful, Pastor. It's better to be seen than viewed. And he makes me laugh at that every single time he told it to me, which is about 40. So in Joel, context, history, there's been a locust invasion. You know about locusts? When they come, the sound is louder than that of a 747 landing at Peoria International Airport. When they come, they eat everything that's above ground. They eat it all. When they're done, there's nothing left. A locust invasion is a serious plague. It looks like the end of the world. It makes a scary Halloween sound. It's a metaphor for destruction, total and complete annihilation. It represents the contingencies in life that are beyond our control, because you cannot control the locusts. I've never been in a locust plague. The worst plague that I ever have received in my life has been either when the love bugs show up in Louisiana in September and you can't keep your windshield clean, or one Sunday morning, Easter sunrise, we are sitting out on the banks of a beautiful little river just flowing into the Gulf of Mexico. It's an absolutely gorgeous Easter Sunday. It's 55 degrees, and suddenly a plague of bugs ascended upon the congregation, and they all bit in everybody's hair. And I'm preaching, and I can't tell what's going on, except that my congregation began to do stuff like this. I thought that they had gotten the spirit and joined the Pentecostal church. They looked like they were dancing in church. That's not very Baptist. And someone looked up at me and went like this. took that to mean, preacher, we need to stop praying and run. I said amen, and everybody started running back to the church. So I've never been in a plague like this, but this stands for anything awful that happens in your life, whether it's flood or tornado or earthquake or tsunami or fire or a cancer you didn't expect to be at the end of your diagnosis or the death of someone that you love with all of your heart. And in the midst of all these plagues, Joel makes this astounding prophet that God will restore our years, that where there is death, there is going to be life. It's almost like Joel is offering us the prequel to the resurrection. That's how big this is. You see, we think of prophets as those people who are always telling us to straighten up and fly right. And those who preach prophetic sermons really usually struggle because they end up making so many people mad. Trust me, I know about this. But you can't just preach prophetic sermons every Sunday, Sunday after Sunday, until you have just beaten your people down to a nub. Even prophets sometimes stop, catch their breath, and offer the promises of God. That's what I'm about to do. That's what I'm about to do. This sermon is for you if you've had a locust plague of any kind. Now stop with me for just a moment. Take a deep breath and try to think through this with me. Can you name the place in your life that has been like a swarm of locusts and imagine that Joel's message is for that part of your life? It's my prayer that you can do that with me this morning. I am remembering a locust plague in my own life. Now, as soon as disaster strikes anywhere in our country, it's always odd to me that the first verbal responders are always a certain stripe of preachers and atheists. They make such an odd couple. When the tsunami hit, just before Christmas, 2004, a Calvinist pastor, positively intoxicated by the grandeur of divine sovereignty, proclaimed that the tsunami was a direct expression of the divine will. Somebody should have slapped him. Our preachers decided long ago that the atheist to blame God for everything that happens is a disastrous theology. It's a travesty to the teaching of the Old and the New Testament. It doesn't help us to ascribe blame to what we cannot understand, to what we did not see coming, and what we cannot change. I don't get it. A lot of people are leaving the church, they tell us. There are two big groups. They're called the nuns and the duns. The nuns have no religious faith left at all, and the duns are just done with the church because they feel the church has hurt them one time too many. But if you leave, you no longer have any help at all with the contingencies and disasters of life and the evil that covers our land like fog. Now, the preachers ought to be smarter than this, but they're not. I went online and looked up preachers, and there are a number of preachers in America who have a tagline, the 10 dumbest things so-and-so ever said. It's just everywhere. One particular evangelist from Virginia, I won't call his name, when Katrina hit New Orleans, he announced that it was God's punishment from the city of New Orleans being so wicked because New Orleans was the modern day Sodom and Gomorrah. You'll forgive me if I took that personally. I went to seminary in New Orleans for 8 years. I went to the French Quarter every night when the library closed because you just can't do seminary 24 hours a day, 7 days a week without going insane. I had to go down to Café du Monde and get some beignets and café au lait, okay? And when he said that God killed us because of our wickedness, I took him to task, but he never responded. I hate it when I'm ignored, don't you? The only thing I hate worse is when you go to sleep in my sermon. But I'm not going to hold it against you. You probably needed the rest. Now, the atheist, by and large, smarter and more interesting than the preachers, they hold forth with perorations and tirades of sexual moralism, gravely and condescendingly informing us that the last slender supports of our Yet as soon as disaster strikes, the atheists come out of the woodwork. They can't wait to say that they have the final and ultimate proof that God does not exist. Regardless of what happens in this world, no one ever comes out of anywhere and actually proves that God doesn't exist. That's a leap of faith. I think it's odd that the atheists can't seem to stop talking about God. Isn't that weird? And oh, by the way, now there are 3 atheist churches in America. This is the beginning of the end for them because they've started churches. That means they'll start fighting each other. That means they'll start splitting. And that soon means that there'll be at least 57 different varieties of atheists, just like there are 57 different varieties of Baptists in America. So I want you to know that it's okay not to listen to the preachers or the atheists who think they know so much, because we are dealing with stuff that we cannot comprehend. Because you and I, when the theologians and the atheists stop babbling, are still stuck with the locusts, those insatiable creatures leaving nothing but bare ground. We are still at ground zero, confused, befuddled, brokenhearted, can't put the pieces back together. We don't need somebody telling us something about what God did. We need somebody to help us with our suffering. Because in Bible times, a locust plague would finish a farmer. I've decided that to be a farmer, you've got to be one tough hombre. Because you just have to sit there and take whatever comes. You can't stop and do anything about a drought. If you're a farmer and you have ever watched your corn shrivel in the field and die, and you don't have anything to show for all you've done, I don't know how they stand. I'm a problem solver. When I see a problem, I want to solve it. It doesn't matter what it is. I'm just programmed that way. I would have never made it as a farmer. I would have become either a complete alcoholic or institutionalized in a mental facility. I don't know how they do it. The locust swarm finishes people. Now think about it metaphorically. It's what kills the spirit of human beings. There's nothing sadder than to have your spirit just squeezed out of you, where you've got no hope left. You've got no heart left. You're just down and out for the count. And you know it's possible to lose spirit because of the way life kicks us around. The locust swarm robs us of our imagination, our creativity, and our trust. The world can harden you to the place that you are angry all the time about everything. It happens to good people. This is not judgment. This is reality. We live in a culture that says a different set of beatitudes from Jesus. Happy are the hard-boiled, for they get their way in the end. Happy are the tough-minded, they run over people and get what they want. What a tragedy it must be to live on the dark side as a sort of corporate Darth Vader, when you can see nothing but evil. The locust swarm can eat away the joy of living, whether you're 16 or 96. Until there's nothing left of you but a sense that the whole world is against you. The system. You blame the system. It's the government's fault. And it's easy to blame the government, because the government, whatever that is, whatever that word means, can be incredibly frustrating. You know, I had this most unbelievable thing happen last year. Somehow, my CPA had filled out my tax returns and managed to take proceeds from my IRA and counted my income and added an extra $18,000 to my income that should have been there. And the next year, the CPA caught the error and revised my tax form and got a check from the government. I got a check for $4,000. And on that day, I didn't have any criticism of the government. I thought, praise the IRS, the IRS. Man, look at this. They sent me money. Where is God when the locusts swarm? That's really what I'm interested in. God is active and present. I want you to know this. We can never lose sight of the presence of God. It's total, it's constant, it never goes away. And God's presence in the plague is more important than who you're going to blame. Because when the locusts come and the rains fall and the bad news rise, I may not know why, but I know who is present. I don't believe God intervenes. I agree with the scientists. God doesn't have to intervene. God's already here. When some Baptists get all fired up about taking God out of public schools, it makes me just about have a conniption fit. I like to say to people, I want you to know that God has never missed a day of school in God's life. Because God's always present everywhere. God doesn't intervene. God persuades us in the direction of goodness and generosity and righteousness. God is always present in nature. For more than 200 years, scientific naturalism has huffed and puffed that there are never any interruptions in the laws of nature. And in spite of all their huffing and puffing, the house of faith has not fallen down, because we are not the two little pigs who built our house out of either straw or twigs. Our faith is built on rock, and this house will not be falling down. God is present in disasters, not the cause of them. God is a persuasive activity, not a coercive activity. Without divine presence, our world will return to utter chaos. The scientific insight that our very existence through evolution requires a universe of the very size, scale, and age that we see around us implies that the universe had us in mind from the beginning. I find that utterly astounding, and science has increased my faith. As the physicist Freeman Dyson puts it, we have a universe that knew we were coming. I like that. The universe knew we were coming. You know why? Because the universe has a creator. A creator. Which is part of all of it. So Joel says, the Lord is gracious and merciful, slow to anger, and abounding in steadfast love. Some folks never hear the word of grace because they have ears only for the noise of the locust. Some people can't hear the voice of grace because they have ears only for criticism and blame. Some people cannot hear the call to worship. Return to me with your heart, with fasting, with weeping, with mourning. Rend your hearts and not your clothing. Blow the trumpet, sanctify a fast, call a solemn assembly, gather the people. Call the people together. When there's a plague, when there's a disaster, when it's not going well, show up at church. Call the people together. See, I think we've lost how radical a thing it is for you to show up here on Sunday morning. I really do. I'm telling you this because I want you to know that you, personally, are critical to what is happening in our world. You show up here for worship, and your presence puts more light into the darkness, more creation into the chaos. You come to church on Sunday morning, and you sit through this, and you tolerate my sermon. You are battling terrorism and violence and hatred and racism and all the powers and principalities that are out to do us in and get rid of us. You show up here and you lend your voice, your support to the cosmic power of goodness, to the persuasive power of God. I want you to know that this really matters, your presence here. The church is a sacred assembly, a gathering of God's people, and it spreads over all time. Church is like a great field of dreams. From megachurch to storefront startup to Gothic cathedrals, angels and a cloud of witnesses show up on Sunday when you show up. If you worship on Sunday, the angels come. Jesus comes. He's promised to be in our midst. The Holy Spirit comes. Remember that wonderful baseball movie, Field of Dreams? It's one of my top 10 baseball movies, and I've seen them all, I'm sure. One of my friends is a religious professor at the University of Dayton, Catholic theologian, Bill Portier. And borrowing from that wonderful baseball movie, he says, coming out of the corn and into the light, instead of shoeless Joe Jackson and the 1919 Chicago White Sox, are Peter and Paul, Martha and Mary, Teresa and Felicity, Francis and Dominique, Aquinas and Augustine, Barth and Bonhoeffer, Jonathan Edwards and Charles Finney, Henry Ward Beecher and John Howard Gilder, William Sloan Coffin Jr. and Martin Luther King Jr. and the faithful men and women whose names we know as if they were members of our immediate family. I love that vision. I love knowing that in this place we have gathered with all the faithful of all the ages. We call it the communion of saints. Of all the things that I've put down as my bedrock convictions, one of them is that I believe in and practice the communion of saints. And after the locusts, the communion of saints shows up. This gathering is our, this gathering is our hope. But in order for us to do what God has called us to do, we must assemble as a people. That's why you come on Sunday. When I was young and raising children, there were three words on the side of a box that scared me to death. Some assembly required. There'd be a 30-page instruction manual and more nuts and bolts and screws than you can count. And my two blocks considered a hammer and a screwdriver. And mostly, my family asked me to stay away from tools because I can't figure out what to do with them. Some assembly required. I would search everywhere to purchase anything I could purchase that I didn't have to try to put together. Because there's a lot of pressure on Christmas Eve night trying to put something together that Santa Claus is going to bring. And let me tell you, you can't let Santa Claus down. He expects you to know how to put that stuff together. You can't just give it to him on Christmas morning and say, oh, by the way, Santa Claus said for you to put it together. Some assembly required. And that's what I'm saying to you. That for the church to be the church, some assembly is required, which requires our faithful presence. Because life is like that big box of pop. And so here's the promise to you. God personally says, I will restore what he hears. I will repay you. It's over the top. God destroys what we almost destroy. When all seems lost, when the locusts have eaten every plant to the nub, out of the left or dead stuff of Jesse, a green shoot appears. I love the green shoot from the stump of Jesse. We've even given him the name that is above all names, and that is the name of Jesus Christ, Lord of Lords and King of Kings. I love this vision, and I'm happy that I've shared it with you today. God revisits every part of the destroyed land, restores it. The soil, the animals, the fields, the pastures, the trees, the rain clouds. We're not the center of this universe. When God comes to restore, he restores creation first. He restores creation first. Then he restores us. At the end of the prophet Jonah's book, there's this amazing thing that says there are all these thousands of people in Nineveh and many animals besides. God didn't just say the people of Nineveh. He saved the animals. And for all of you who dearly love animals because they're so easy to love, that's a great task. God restores our lost years, reconstitutes life from death. He gives us back our years. We've been studying about it in the book of Luke. A tax collector cries, God be merciful to me, a sinner. And Jesus says, I restore the years. A widow cries, give me justice. And Jesus says, I restore your years. 10 lepers cry out, have mercy on us. And Jesus says, I restore the years. Jesus raises Lazarus from the dead and restores the years. Don't you get it? Don't you get it? Don't you see it? The promise belongs to you, and you, and you, and you, and you. The promise belongs to all God's creation. I will restore the years that the locusts have eaten. I can only think of one response that matters to that. I'll stand for you. I knew you wouldn't know. It's called Amen. It's a lost art, right? But that's a sermon for another.